In the previous episode, we gathered a lot of information and even did some security research into a potential DOM clobbering technique. And in this video, we try to piece together all the little things that lead to solving this challenge. We know from the description that the whole attack starts with TJ Mike from Pasteurize. So we can create an XSS on Pasteurize that sets the window name to our attack debug JSON string and then redirects to all the little things with the debug parameter, which then takes our debug string from the window name and applies it to the user. We don't know yet how that leads to being able to XSS or just how to extract the flag, but this is the best start we have right now. Now we can think about how we can use this debug JSON to our advantage and do something nasty. And the first thing that came to our mind was obviously controlling the theme. The theme is an attribute on the user object and it is used in update theme to set the callback handler of the JavaScript that is embedded. So if we would set the theme callback to our example alert, when the user and the theme is loaded, it would embed alert as a script and execute it. But when we try that, it doesn't work. We get an error when we try to apply merge this debug object with the user because property theme has only a getter. We can see in the user class that the theme is in fact a getter function and it cannot be set. This getter function accesses the internal private hash theme attribute, which we cannot set with this either. I thought the plan forward was clear, but this threw a wrench into the wheel. This is where I really got stuck. But then Managama from our team immediately had an idea. Let's overwrite the prototype of the object. The prototype of an object defines basically the base class functionality, and the prototype of the user includes things like the getter functions. Overwriting the prototype of the user throws those away. Let's try this. We set underscore underscore proto underscore underscore to an empty object, and maybe now our theme definition can take over. Let's refresh the page, and yes, we get an alert. So load theme accessed the theme from the user we set, used the callback name alert, created the script tag with our name, which looks like this, so it executes alert with this parameter. Cool, but what now? Unfortunately, we are still far from being done. So before we reached this point, we actually already had played around with the JSONP endpoint because we wanted to know what we are allowed to use as a callback parameter. If we, for example, could write here any JavaScript, we could create a fetch request to take the page content and send it away. This could be used to leak the list of private nodes, so we would then basically have solved the challenge. But if you try that as an actual callback parameter, you see that almost all symbols are removed. So we iterated through all the characters to see which characters are allowed, and we found out it's all letters, numbers, dot, and equal. That's very restrictive. But we are still making small progress and we know we are getting closer. So we have here a script gadget. We have the ability to insert one statement into here and somehow that has to get us one step closer to the flag. Let's think about this logically. What ability does this actually give us? First of all, we can call any function we want, like alert, but we don't control the parameter. We always have this odd object as an argument. We also have dot available, so we can call basically any function that exists. We can do things like object.constructor.apply. Okay, so ability one, call any function. But this is not all. We also have the equal symbol, and this allows us to assign a value to something. We can have blah equal to ASD, but ASD will also be a function call. Overall, both options are very restrictive, but we knew there must be some tricks. And we just started playing around with this. We did this simply by opening the developer tools and try to write JavaScript with this kind of pattern to see if we could do something. I, for example, wanted to call fetch to send away the page data, so I tried to figure out a way how I could call fetch. Of course, fetch with this parameter makes no sense because we need to get a URL into there. So I started to think of things like .bind because after the bind function call, it still returns the original function just with .this bound to the object passed in. Just very weird stuff, very aimlessly just playing around. But eventually, this led to the realization we could write stuff into the inner HTML of some element. And that was a first breakthrough. We could do something like document.body.innerHTML equal and then something that returns a string. If we, for example, do this with alert, the alert call doesn't return anything. The return value is undefined. But we can still see that the document body HTML is all written with undefined. So if we somehow can control the string that is assigned to innerHTML, we could do a full XSS, right? This again took some playing around because remember, we always have a function call on the right side, but we figured something out. I decided to use an input element with a value set to the payload I want to inject. This way I'm able to get a string into the page. And remember from DOM clobbering how we can access this? In theory, I just want to access window.xss.value to read the string and assign it to innerHTML. But again, we have this function call here. And obviously we can't call this string as a function. But then with playing around, it also clicked, we can call toString. So calling toString on the string just returns our string. Another small trick that helped us. Awesome. At first, I chose an image tag with onError. If we try to execute it as if we use the window.name debug trick, we can see the broken image loaded, which means our payload somewhat worked, but no alert box. Unfortunately, we run into the next problem. Refuse to execute inline event handler because it violates the content security policy. The CSP is very restrictive. It requires a script tag with a random nonce you cannot predict, or you need a script tag but with the source hosted on the same self URL. Crap. But wait, our JSONP endpoint allows us to create a minimal script that is hosted on the same self domain. So we should be able to inject a script tag with another theme and a callback of our choice. This would give us an extremely limited script, but now we can inject multiple of them and we can maybe build more complex primitives that way. But of course we have another problem. This actually doesn't work because script tags assigned with innerHTML are not executed. The HTML5 specification actually says that, note, script elements inserted using innerHTML do not execute when they are inserted. Oh man, so many little steps forward and we are still not there. And this is where another trick comes into play. Using an iframe with no source, but a source doc that contains the script tag. I cannot remember how I came up with it. I think maybe I saw that trick before and I just tried it out, or I stumbled over it again while researching CSP bypasses. But either way, it's out there, it's a thing. This will create an iframe with a new document that contains the script tag, and new document means the script tag has to be executed. This works even though CSP itself does not allow iframes. At least if we try to actually iframe something else, we get a CSP violation, but we only get that because we try to load a specific source. We are not loading a source here. We are simply embedding an iframe inside this page with a custom document, and that document happens to have a script tag. Sneaky, awesome trick. We still cannot do full XSS in there because we are still bound to CSP, but we can now insert multiple JSONP theme callback scripts and then chain them. I think you understand how we walked very little steps forward and gained more and more abilities. But the video is getting very long, so I think to fill the last remaining puzzle pieces, let's just look at our solution. So this is the window name debug JSON string that we inject. We see we overwrite the proto so that we can set the theme callback parameter. Our initial payload is basically what I showed you already, setting the innerHTML of something. But instead of using a DOM clobbered input element with a value, I'm actually abusing the window.name itself. This is a trick I figured out all the way at the end, because the problem with our original idea was that the victim would have to have access to a node with such an input element. And the logged in victim couldn't access our private nodes. So we couldn't create a node to get our payload string in there. But we can control this window.name string. And this might be a bit mind-bending, but window.name is just a string. This is just text. It looks like JSON, but this is just text. It will be parsed and interpreted as JSON when loaddebug is called, but window.name is just text. So setting the innerHTML to this text, this will be garbage normal text, but here we have now HTML tags, and it will render this HTML. Does that make sense? And well, the HTML it will render is an iframe with a source doc, and that source doc contains a few HTML elements. So let's investigate what happens in there. I executed the JavaScript as if the JSONP theme callback was embedded and executed. Here you can see the injected text, and then it renders this iframe. The first element in the iframe is an image tag with the ID X. It contains a link to a Burp collaborator URL. So this is just a URL where we can't see any requests sent to it. You see, it's intended to leak stuff. This image will make sense in just a moment. Next, we have three script tags. All three load the theme URL with a special callback parameter. You can see here essentially the three lines that are being executed. First, we overwrite the overall object prototype of the toString function and set it to the regex toString function. Remember that prototype tells an object what it basically inherits? So all general objects toString functions now become the toString implementation from a more special regex object. Then we set the attribute source of all objects to the text of the parent document. So this reaches out of the iframe, goes into the parent and gets the text. This gets the IDs of all the nodes. And then we set the source of our image to X by calling concat on the source string. Remember, this is how the whole JavaScript string looks like. So this line normally would simply concat this object parameter with the URL already in the image source tag. But because we did this magic here before, the source of the concat copy is now our leaked text. So internally, it will not concat this parameter, but actually uses the text we extracted before and set as a source. And when the source is set on an image, the browser attempts to load this image, sending a request to that URL. At least that's what I think happens, because what the fuck is this magic? We didn't come up with this. We actually went through all the published research from the challenge author, Ter Yang. We stumbled over this tweet. I recently discovered a fancy way to execute arbitrary XSS without parentheses. As far as I'm concerned, this is a novel technique. Our payload is a variation of this. By playing around, we were able to figure out and construct a primitive with the image to concat the URL with the document text, thus creating this image URL, sending the request and leaking the page content. Now we have everything that we need to solve this challenge. We just need to pull off this XSS twice. Here's the recording from the CTF, just before we solved it. Here I'm constructing the XSS payload for pasteurize. This eval blob here simply sets the window.name to the JSON payload we just looked at. Then it redirects to the node overview page. As explained, this will cause the whole chain to kick off and eventually result in the image tag inside the iframe to load the leak URL with the page content of the parent, leaking any private node IDs to our Burp collaborator server. And here's the image load request. In there, you can find the private secret node IDs of TJ Mike. And next, we do the same payload, but instead of leaking the node overview page, we want the full content of this particular node. Do the same steps again, reporting this pasteurized post with the XSS to TJ Mike. This fires off all the little things that get executed in a chain, resulting in leaking the private node, which we can find leaked here. And there is the flag. When the world comes to an end, all that matters are all these little things. Aww. We submitted and we were the 20th team to solve it. The last team to solve it. Just about 2 hours before the end of the CTF.